session is about mobile web rising, and this is kind of a super nice talk. And so let me introduce a bit for those who haven't been to my sessions yesterday. Well, this is my family name, which is completely unpronounceable. I'm completely agree with you. Actually, my father, he works in as an architect in Buenos Aires, in Argentina, and he when he calls his providers of material for building houses, they call him the architect Alberto. Yeah, I'd like to talk with the architect Alberto. Yeah, of course, I pass him the, and he tells me, you imagine if I tell them the family name, we could be until tomorrow trying to help them pronounce it. I have this small shop called Kosmaczewski, which is based in Switzerland, and you can find me here mainly in Kosmo.com, in Kosmaczewski, in Twitter, and in all these nice places all over the web. Okay? So very easily, I started working writing applications for this great device, right, that allows you to make phone calls. Not that one, I mean the other one on the right. And basically, that involves a lot of fiddling with, you know, Objective-C and code, okay? Which is, okay, fine, but for many people, it's like a no. Because, I mean, you have to get into pointers and sys-structs and, you know, getting into memory management. It can be a bit heavy sometimes. So I started wondering about alternatives, right? What could you use as a technology to create the same kind of applications without having to touch that? And it became like an early concern for me, saying, okay, let's try to see other alternatives. And actually, I wrote an article, this is a screenshot from 2009, from this article, which is called iPhone Apps Without Objective-C. You can go check it out in my website. Where I keep updated, I keep the article updated with new entries every so often because I find new frameworks. And actually, it's amazing the quantity of alternative frameworks that you have to create iPhone apps without those technologies, right? And I think it's without some level of maturity in all those tools. Okay, we've been doing iPhone apps for, let's say now, 3.5 years, Android app for at least 3 years probably, a bit longer. Now we have these great Windows mobile devices coming out. I mean, I was absolutely amazed to see the demos a couple of minutes ago. I don't know, for those who were in the keynote, it's amazing. I think, actually, personal opinion, it's the only real contender to the iPhone is Windows Mobile. I mean, it really goes beyond Android in terms of developer experience and capabilities of the devices and standardization of the platform, which is really, really useful for us in terms of the developer. I don't want to have my application not running on the HTC whatever and yes in the Galaxy, Samsung Galaxy. You know, it's like I want to have a unified developer experience. I want to have that. I want maturity. And that's the main thing. And there was a presentation that I made in 2009 in Zurich, which is about mobile app frameworks. So I already started considering back at the time the web as another very strong alternative. Okay, at the time it was a bit sketchy. I'm not going to hide this fact from you. But again, the previous slide about the maturity, I think it applies to the web as well right now, and that's why we're all here right now. I think that the market has evolved. I think that the web has evolved. And we have arrived to a point where we can now seriously consider the mobile web as a really serious alternative to native applications, okay? And let me tell you a story. I'm following mostly the Swiss market because I work in Switzerland, okay? I follow the trends. I try to see where my clients want to go to build their applications. And given the economic crisis that we have in Europe right now, many companies, when they are now analyzing their options for mobile strategy, they say, okay, the iPhone is not enough because there's a lot of Android phones, the Windows Mobile is coming up, so we want to have an investment, so we are ready to go mobile, but we don't want to spend N times the number of platforms, N being the number of platforms. So it's a sizable investment. And I've had this year already 3 or 4 requests for mobile web apps. So that prompted me saying that this is really going to be huge next year. So my prediction, if you want. I'm not Gardner, I'm not Forrester, okay? I'm Kosmaczewski, which is even worse. But the thing is, I think that the mobile web will really explode next year in terms of a market force for us providers of software solutions to companies, like many of you, I suppose, you are providers for the global market. This is going to explode. I'm not even saying that it will grow. It will explode. Let me tell you another story. I have a friend of mine who's a Flash developer. I was telling this anecdote to a couple of you yesterday between the talks. This guy was telling me, I've been working as a Flash developer for the past 12 years, since the late 90s, doing Flash stuff, sites and everything. He told me, I met him a couple of days ago, he told me, this year I didn't have not only one contract, I'm only doing maintenance. There's no more Flash development in Switzerland. I mean, and he worked in Zurich, which is the most important, economically most important city of Switzerland. And I was, because I knew that it was going down, but I didn't know that it was going to disappear completely. It disappeared completely. And he tells me, I'm going HTML5. I leave it up to that, guys, but this is how it's going. This is how it's going in the heart of Europe. This is how the trends are going. So that's what I wanted to do. So the first important thing that you have to consider when you're going to this way is the trade-offs between web and native apps. This is super important to understand. This is something that we're going to spend a couple of minutes, because there are a couple of trade-offs, okay? Web apps are powerful, but still not as powerful as native apps. However, they fit the bill quite nicely in a lot of opportunities, in a lot of situations. So for that, I usually show this graphic that basically puts in the x-axis the complexity of the UI, or if you want, also the update frequency of an application, the usage frequency of an application, and the update frequency in the y-axis, okay? And this framework helps me when I meet a client, and this is something that you can use. Actually, I borrowed this from Apple. I haven't actually came up with this, but I found that it's really useful. When I sit down with a client to decide which strategy we are going to pursue, I show them this graphic. And actually, it turns out that, for example, business apps fall into that quadrant of the graphic. For those of you, it's a double entry axis, graphic. Business apps, for example, are updated very frequently. Business rules have to change all the time, new regulations, but basically, they are not used that frequently. They're more like, they take the shape of dashboards. It's something that I launch, I want to see some information, I close it, okay? I take some decision after that. However, we have to keep, for the business to be relevant, the rules have to change every so often. So it's very useful to have them in just one central location in a web application. It makes sense to use web technologies for that. The same for report. However, they are used sometimes more frequently by business decision takers. A calculator is neither updated frequently, neither used frequently, and games usually are used very frequently because we love to play games when we're on the bus, we are waiting to arrive at our workplace, we are on the plane, we don't know what to do. The in-flight entertainment system sucks, which is how it happens often. So you basically pull up your smartphone and you start playing Angry Birds, and that's how it goes. And it turns out that web apps and native apps basically fall into these quadrants of the graphic. Okay, so this might give you an idea about where to use web apps and where not to use web apps. But there's another important factor. Actually, the y-axis actually it's also correspond to cross-platform compatibility. Okay, web apps are actually right now the only true solution for cross-platform compatibility between mobile apps. Okay, in all the jungle of technologies that you can use for web, for mobile web or development, for mobile development in general, the web for me is really the only true option in terms of cross platform. There are some frameworks like Titanium Accelerator that do the same thing. However, I'm strongly believer about the web technologies in the sense that for enterprise customers in particular, they are a known technology. Web enterprise customers, they know how to deal with the web. They have websites, they have intranets, so their teams are really comfortable with that. So it's usually just a matter of taking them into the mobile way of thinking, of adapting to new visual paradigms, usage paradigms of, you know, immediacy, speed, relevance of the information, you know, these kind of things. You have to change a bit of the mindset, but the technologies themselves are known. We're talking about HTML5, JavaScript, and CSS. Very well, I have also a graph double entry table that I use to basically put in context the pros and the cons of web and native apps, but JavaScript engines are getting better. JavaScript engines are getting better. When you see what you can get from the V10 engine from Google, it's absolutely, excuse me, the V10, the V8, V8 or V10? V8, thank you very much. Yeah, I always mix V10 and V8. It's absolutely amazing. Now you have Node built on top of that V8 engine, and actually it's the hot new stuff, and it's incredible because we, 50 years later, after the first idea for Netscape of having a JavaScript-based web server, we come back to the same idea with Node.js, but we've gone a long way. So now if we have these kind of engines in our mobile smartphones, I mean, things can change, so it's very important to keep an eye on that. On the case of the native applications, particularly for iOS, but other marketplaces as well, you have a review process that you have to go through. It might be a problem, it might be something that you don't want to deal with. And there is also a longer update time. That is, the user has to approve the update process, has to say, oh, there's a new version of this application, would you like to update? You have to say yes, so there's a possibility of the user still getting stuck with an old version of your app, and you have to call him and say, ah, but you're using the old version, why didn't you update it? Finally. And it's like, so then again, the web app basically has the advantage of not having to deal with that. The update will be done automatically. And it turns out that I was at the Yahoo conference. It's a very nice conference in Denmark, in the second city of Denmark. It's called Aarhus. And that's where the Google headquarters are in Denmark, and that's where the team of the V8 engine works, okay? That's very important. The V8 Google engine was created in Denmark. In the same city, there's a conference called Yahoo, now it's called Goto. And I was there in 2010, last year, 1 year ago, and I wrote this tweet because I've seen V8, I've seen how other technologies were coming down, and I said, wait a second, we are arriving to a point where the mobile web is rising, and then that's where the name of this talk came out, okay? So, very important to see some numbers, to figure out what's going on with the mobile web. So it's very important to know that as of February 2011, 4.7% of all browsing worldwide was done using mobile devices, okay? So 4.7%. Let's put this number in perspective. That's March 2011, it's 6 months ago. In March 2010, the number was 1.96%. So we went from 1.96% to 4.7% in 1 year. The latest numbers I've seen so far tend to say that we are approaching the 10%. Right now, not in March 2012, but right now. So this is going exponentially up. Okay, I'm talking about numbers that go exponentially up. Mobile web browsing on smartphone devices is exploding, literally. Okay, the trend is going to go upwards faster than it's going now. That's another very important thing, and it concerns countries, developing countries like India, like South America, like Africa. It's something that is very dear to me because it's happening in my home country, in Argentina as well. Okay, in the third world, if you want, in developing countries, the proportion is even higher. In Sudan, in Africa, you can go even in Chad, near 30% of all web browsing done in the country was done on a smartphone. Why? Because it's not cheaper to get a smartphone than to get a computer. Many people are getting to the web for the first time because they have a phone with a big screen and a nice browser, and they can access web services out of it. So the whole thing is exploding, okay? So there's a huge opportunity down there to provide quality services for our countries. You know, I come from Argentina, so I know what it feels like. A lot of, a big part of this population completely locked out from progress and knowledge and Wikipedia and whatnot. And now you have the kids in the favelas in Brazil, they are able to access the previous part of lesson, we were able to access Wikipedia to create, to make the assignments at school. How cool is that? You know, and this guy, girls and boys who have never been able to access the web. So in social terms, it has a tremendous, tremendous impact. And the predictions are that the mobile web will overcome the usage of normal desktop web by 2015. I think this is conservative. 2014, I think this is conservative. It might happen as early as next year, if you ask me. But then again, don't take my word, I'm not a forester or government. Another very important thing to know is which are the browsers that are part of this game. And for the moment, this is statistics of early this year, this is March 2011. Safari had a big size of a chunk. However, Android is catching up. The latest stats that I've seen, I haven't updated this slide lately, but Android is catching up. It's almost second right now in web browsing. So it's very interesting to see how WebKit on Android is being used as well. BlackBerry is not progressing, it's actually stagnating at a certain position, which is quite sad. Another very important thing to take into account is the fact that WebKit is the big winner of the mobile development wars, okay? Which is kind of a payback on IE somehow. IE is completely non-existent in the mobile development world, at least so far. But WebKit is being used in Android, iOS, BlackBerry 6, Baga, and I don't know how many, Nokia, and Nigo as well. So basically, it's one of the most used engines on the world, in the world of mobile smartphone development. However, WebKit is a family, actually. It's not just one browser. Basically, each vendor is able to get the WebKit source code and do whatever they want with it. So basically, there are differences. Very important difference. And in the Quicks Mode site, in Quicks Mode / webkit.html, there's a comparison of the different WebKits. And I strongly suggest that you, if you are going to go the way of the mobile web, to take a look at it, because even if WebKit is the most used, not all features of WebKit are available all over the smartphone platforms. Okay, there's a sizable baseline that's available everywhere that is we can build upon, but some particular features are not available everywhere. So, in terms of technologies, it's all of a big soup, okay? So I'm just going to name some technologies that are actually making splashing news all over the place. In particular, those that are... I said... Hello? Hello? I'm sorry. I'm going back. Boom, start again. Start or swap to advance, yeah. I'm trying, you don't let me. Anyway, well, I leave it like that, very easy. It's just an animation with all of these things popping up. Basically, you can see here that things like geolocation, SVG, web storage, calendar, HTML5, CSS3, the file writer, web sockets, contacts API, messaging API, we are going really into a standardization of high-level APIs all over the mobile web, okay? We are going to be able to do more and more with the native web APIs from our browsers, okay? And the web applications group from the W3C is really advancing quite fast. Since the release of the HTML5 first draft, things are going accelerating into the W3C. So it's very interesting to see the directions that this whole technology soup is taking, okay? So let me just, and this is the big problem, complexity. It's like, how do you manage the fact that the same technologies are not available all over the place? How do you create compelling user interfaces using all of these things, okay? And that's where frameworks come into place, okay? And there's a bit of a fashion around them. Frameworks come and go. There's a lot of contenders in the place. However, after 1.5 or 2 years of evolution, some of them are coming up as the big winners in the frameworks race for mobile web applications, okay? Some of them are pioneers. I call them the pioneer frameworks. The first of them being IUI, created by Joe Hewitt. We all know Joe Hewitt because of Firebird, because of the Facebook iPhone application. A really smart guy who came up with basically the first framework to create mobile applications that look like an iPhone application on your browser. Okay, so basically it was a very simple framework. It just took an HTML page, a couple of JavaScript files, a CSS, and basically you could get an application that looked like and act like a native iPhone app using standard technologies. Okay, so if you see the kind of HTML that you need, it's really standard HTML lists and this kind of thing. So basically, very smart way of taking. Then there was kind of the establishment, okay? This IUI came up in late 2008, was very popular. Now it's seldom used, it's actually been completely abandoned. There are some other frameworks who took up in 2009 and 2010 who became really popular. The biggest contender in this sense is JQ Touch, which is a plugin for jQuery. jQuery is this enormously popular library that I'm pretty sure everyone has used at one point or another. However, jQuery Touch is being basically phased out. Yeah, somebody calling? jQuery Touch is being a bit phased out right now because of the upcoming jQuery Mobile. jQuery Mobile will be it's on release candidate 3 as we speak. It will have a formal 1.0 in a couple of weeks or days if it's not already done. It's a really, really interesting thing. There's jQuery UI as well, that it's a strong option for your mobile web apps. And of course, Sencha Touch, which I'm really, really fanatic about it. I'm doing one project on Sencha Touch. I've been to SenchaCon last week in Austin, in Texas. They are coming up with not only an incredible framework, the Sencha in itself, it's evolved from EXT. I don't know, who has used EXT in the past? Yeah, okay. You know how cool it could be to create a web app for your desktop browser. Well, imagine the same power, but on your touch screen. It's absolutely awesome. I strongly recommend you take a look. I'm not affiliated with Sencha. I'm just a very happy developer. I'm creating a couple of projects with it. It's really cool. But the nice thing is that they come with a complete enterprise offering, including the IDE to create the user interface by drag and drop. We're talking about interface builder for the mobile web. This is the first company that's doing such a thing, okay? They have also the CSS animator tool, so if you want to create animations for your mobile or desktop applications, you have an IDE that allows you to create standard-based JavaScript and CSS animations. Awesome, awesome, awesome stuff. I think this is a very strong contender. Probably the only ones that come close to Sencha Touch right now is Sproutco, which has there is a work going on to adapt it from mobile, but for the moment it's not yet there. There's been talks about Cappuccino as well, to have them provide some kind of mobile. Now, Cappuccino has been bought by Motorola, and Motorola Mobility has been bought by Google. So I really don't know what's the status of Cappuccino, because, you know, in companies bopping one another, and then you don't know exactly where are the developers. So anyway, there's also Dojo Mobile for those who are who've been using Dojo in your desktop web apps. Go on and take a look, because it's the same APIs but for mobile experience. And then, but these are frameworks, like really complex stuff, okay? We are talking about Sencha Touch. It has a documentation like the one that you get from MSDN, you know? It's like APIs with all the methods and all the parameters and the methods. So sometimes you need something lightweight. Depending on what you really want to go lightweight. So there's a huge range of lightweight frameworks. The ones that are really making the headlines these days is Zep.js. Zep.js, the team behind Zep.js, is part of the old prototype team. Remember the prototype JavaScript library? Okay, some of the team is doing Zepto right now. Among them, Thomas Fuchs, which is probably one of the people in the world who knows more about JavaScript. There's also, I will go very fast around it. XUI is getting very popular in Switzerland. This one, the Joe framework, webapp.net is being used in Switzerland as well for a couple of mobile apps that work very well. This is the one, actually, the public transport of Geneva uses an application created with webapp.net. You have base.js, lang.js, mobi, Goody, And there's more, let me tell you. The HTML5 boilerplate, you can use this, of course, it's an open source project, you can use it to base your next application. You have the Not Just a Grid project. You have the chocolate chip mobile. You have snippet space, unify, SK, AK, yeah, something like that. IP faces, Wink, the Sapphire framework, JPint, just like, you know what I mean? I mean, there's like a lot going on. I mean, there's a lot of very, very interesting, very smart people working for the creation of JavaScript frameworks for the web, okay? So pay attention. When you see a lot of very smart people paying attention to one particular spot, it's like you have to pay attention and really see what's going on. Then there's enterprise offerings. This is Yahoo Blueprint. It's being used by some companies in some companies in Switzerland as well. Basically, it's a platform that allows you to define in XML files the layout of your application plus the business logic, the server-side APIs that you want to tackle and everything. And basically, Blueprint will create an experience using this kind of XML where you define very, very abstract way the kind of interaction, the pages, and everything that has to do to a particular application. Blueprint will take that XML and will create an experience that will be tailored to the particular mobile device that you're using, no matter which mobile device. So basically, Yahoo Blueprint takes care of translating that to Symbian. If you are using an old version of a Symbian browser, if you are using BlackBerry 4 or 5, if you are using the first iPhone, the first Safari, whatever mobile device you are using, you are going to get an experience that matches the capabilities of your browser. So it's actually quite interesting to see what they are doing. It's being used by companies in Europe, I know quite a few, and they are very happy with it. So, but again, this is another option that I think that you can see. And then you can go beyond the browser, because once you've got a nice web app, why not selling it on an app marketplace, okay? And that's where, yeah, I have to say app marketplace, because App Store, it's a trademark from Apple, and I don't want to have any lawsuits or anything. So I say app marketplace, and that basically, it takes to the Android market, the BlackBerry app world, the Yovie store, or whatever the name of Nokia store right now. And there are several options. The first of course, is Accelerator. Accelerator allows you to create, using web technologies, you can create a mobile application that you can then distribute through a mobile app, app marketplace. But my personal pet peeve, of course, is PhoneGap. PhoneGap has gone a long, long, long way from an underdog project. It's been promoted to be an Apache project, so let's be very clear, now it is an Apache project with all the Apache Foundation behind, plus the money from Adobe, who has basically bought the Newtobi, the company that created PhoneGap. Okay, so we are talking about a standard that is growing up, it's getting funded with the backing of a huge company like Adobe behind. It's really, really interesting to see where they're going. The contender of PhoneGap, if you want, that it was and pretty much offers the same kind of functionality as NimbleKit. It allows you to basically wrap your web files into a native application. And then you have Web Mobile, which is another application framework that uses Ruby. It allows you to create your web application using web technologies plus Ruby, and you can wrap all of that into a native app. So then again, this imagination at work, you know, taking your favorite technology and say, okay, how can I make my web app using my favorite technology? And that's really cool. That's really cool because we are getting to a point where many of these tools are getting mature. And in the case of PhoneGap, I think brilliant future ahead. In my personal opinion, and this is a white slide, this is between you and me, I'm a strong fan of jQuery Mobile and Sencha plus PhoneGap. Okay, so these are the three big names, and this is part of my offering. I've made it a formal part of my offering. It's technologies that I plan to support for my clients, and so far the results I'm getting out of them is outstanding. I don't even say very good, I say outstanding. And then, once you have your application, you could probably not even sell it on an app marketplace, but on a web app marketplace. I don't know how many of you know openappmarket.com. How many of you know it? One person, very good. Well, openappmarket.com is basically like the app store for web apps. And it's really interesting. I strongly recommend you that you check it out with your Android or iOS phone. It installs itself like a small application on your home screen of your device. And when you open it up, you can browse web apps, you can buy web apps with your credit card, and they get installed as another icon in your home screen. And it's a really interesting approach to this whole thing. Actually, we are doing, I think, quite well. It's not an exploding thing, but it's growing steadily. So it's something to watch out as well. But then again, talking about your question, what about examples? I mean, and personally, I've been absolutely amazed seeing the Financial Times iPad app. How many of you have seen the Financial Times iPad app? Okay, let me make a demo, because I'm on an iPad right now. So I'm going to go, and I'm going to select on my web apps folder. I have here the Financial Times web app. And I don't have a network connection right now. I mean, it has an overrange, but I cannot connect to anything. And basically, the app will load the content from the last time that I connected to a site. So right now it's trying to connect unsuccessfully because the, let me just disable the Wi-Fi that I'm not using. So I force it to go offline. Let me go again. Financial Times. There we go. Excuse me? There we go. So now this is the Financial Times web application. This is built on web technology. This is pure web technology, what you're seeing here. I don't have a subscription to the Financial Times, so I cannot see the contents, okay? But I can, for example, go to the menu, and I can see the different sections, and I can jump from one to the other. And of course, I have like some settings that I can change, the size of the fonts and everything. And basically, I can connect to this web application before going into my plane, before boarding my plane, get all the information and read it while I'm on the go. And the Financial Times has dropped their iPad application. They are offering this as their standard iPad application, basically as a way of avoiding to pay a 30% of every new subscription to Apple. So check it out. It's absolutely, absolutely out of this planet, I think. I was really, really surprised and pleased to see how this is going. Another very simple example is the Disney Watch Store application, which I made with a partner company in London. The Disney is a super popular blog among designers. And you can see a small clock if you go with your iPhone right now, your Android, you can go to disneywatchstore.com/clock. And if you're on an iPhone, you can basically add it to the home screen. And when you add it to the home screen, you can use it even on your iPhone, on your iPad. So let me show it to you because I have it right here. And this is the application loading from the local cache of my iPad. It's working completely offline, as you can see. I've disabled the Wi-Fi. And the whole thing adapts, of course, as well. It's a very simple example, okay? It adapts in portrait and landscape, and it's a very weird watch. It's a designer thing. So basically, these are the seconds, as you can imagine. These are the minutes, and these are the hours, okay? It goes in a 24-hour cycle, okay? And this thing changes the color depending on the hour of the day. It goes from green to purple, going all through the other colors. It's a designer thing, but it was a nice project to create. And then we came up with the idea of creating a real app with this, and basically it turned out that the only thing that we had to do is take in the same source code. This application, this clock, uses Raphael. Who knows Raphael? Raphael is a super nice framework in JavaScript for vector apps. I'm going to speed up. We have the possibility of creating an offline web app by using standard HTML tags and a bit of the cache manifest. The HTML5 cache manifest allows you to store files and everything offline in your web app. It's very nice. So remember that web development is software development, so all the rules of web software development apply here. So have a spec, have a schedule, architecture, prototype, human tester, very important. This is real software development, okay? You automate your tests, builds, use bug database, version control, design, know your audience, and scope your target. Who knows this guy? You know the famous Joel Spolsky, Joel test, apply the Joel test to your team. This is strong software development. This is not crappy web stuff. We are talking about really enterprise production applications. It's very important to test in multiple devices because the web is the web and there might be differences between iPhone and Android, Windows Phone 7 and company. Okay? Some links for you that I leave right here that will be on the link. Standards for web applications on mobile, Quirks mode, fundamental. If there's one place that you have to go for your web application needs, it's Quirks mode. Awesome website. And some books, very quickly. If you want to go serious into mobile web, you have to read this book. And I suggest that you go right now to Amazon and you buy it for your Kindle or you buy it on O'Reilly. This is awesome. And not only that, but the guy is from Argentina, and he's actually a friend of mine. So go on, buy his book now, right? He's a great guy. This guy came to me last week. He gave an awesome talk about web technologies for mobile. This book is a Bible. The guy, he can tell you that in the Symbian S15 of the Nokia 5100, actually, the H1 tag has a bug, and you're like, what? He knows everything about any browser of any mobile platform. It's a 500 pages book. It's a Bible. Another one, not so good, but I name it as well, Smartphone Web Development from APS, Building iPhone Apps on HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. There's another one in this book by my same friend Maximiliano on jQuery Mobile. This one is an early release. You can buy the book at a discount and then you get the updates. Right now, the book is being written as we speak. And then the Mobile Developer's Guide to the Galaxy. This is a free ebook you can download from the web. If you put Mobile Developer's Guide to the Galaxy in Google, you're going to get it. There's a section about mobile web applications as well. And having said that, thank you very much. And I'm open, of course, to any questions you may have. Thank you very much.